lungs burn when I record for Watts. And every black like Troy Davis who never had a fair shot. All black, everything, everything black. Culture over everything, y'all, we taking it back, black.
Good evening, folks. Welcome to Letters Bookshop this evening. This is a special presentation, special live taping of a show called Left of Black, which is produced in conjunction with the John Hope Franklin Center at Duke University. I'm your host. I'm Mark Anthony Neal. We've been doing the show now for 6 seasons. Wow. We've shot more than 150 episodes.
Wow.
This particular event tonight is also being co-sponsored by the Center for Arts and Digital Culture and Entrepreneurship, and also the Duke Council on Race and Ethnicity. And what we want to do is kind of take ourselves out of the comfort zone and to be able to do a little bit more stuff in the community. And Land, who's the owner here at a Letters Bookshop, was very gracious to open his space, you know, for us to have this conversation. Our guests tonight are directly to my left, Bert Ashe, who is a professor of English and American Studies at the University of Richmond. The reason why we're here tonight, because of his book, Twisted, My Dreadlock Chronicles. And we're also joined by Natalie Bullock Brown, who teaches film and media at St. Augustine University. St. Augustine University. She is also working on a new documentary film project, Bartman, Beyonce, and Me. So we thought it'd be a nice opportunity to talk about kind of the politics of black beauty, the politics of black hair, and have a kind of conversation about it. If you're interested in following any of us on Twitter, you can find Bert, who I know doesn't do a whole lot of Twitter.
I try my best to tweet. At Twisted Book.
At Twisted Book. Natalie is NatalieBB2. Yep. And you can follow me at New Black Man. You can also use the hashtag Left of Black in order to help people track the conversation. So we're going to begin with Bert reading a little bit from Twisted, and then we'll jump into the conversation.
Great. I'm going to read a section called Going Outside that is from a portion of the book that is called Twisted. Or I'm sorry, Golden Age. Going Outside 6. The magnetic tug of suburbia was too strong. I couldn't summon enough escape velocity to transcend it. I hate that cheesy saying, anywhere you go, there you are, but it's true. Reinvention is overrated. Identity is not substitutive, identity is additive. And anyway, passing for bohemian might just be more fun than actually being bohemian. I went to a rock club called the Nancy Ray Gun one night some years back down on then gritty Gray Street here in Richmond. Some VCU kids during Fashion Week were screening Afropunk. The original title is Afropunk, the Rock and Roll Nigger Experience. Richmond's black punk rock community was out and down. I'd never been to the Ray Gun before, and I didn't get back to it before it closed, but that night the club was a bizarre fusion of cozy and homey, what with a table of cookies and brownies and the cheery, welcoming vibe of those hosting the screening, combined with the rough, grungy club interior and aggressive styles. Spiky hair, tattoos, torn black clothing, studs and piercings worn by the attendees. The tension between open as a warm hug and tough as a punch to the face was intoxicating. Before the film started, I sat at the bar, had a beer, chatted with a black guy who looked exactly like novelist Paul Beatty. This guy was even named Paul. And a white guy who was attending Mary Washington College. I have no idea what they thought of me, of why I was there, of what I represented. Before long, the young black punk who had organized the screening stood up to introduce the film, and she became increasingly emotional as she talked about the depths of what the film meant to her. I stood in the middle of the audience, black punks and white punks to my left and to my right, and black punks on screen talking about the black punk experience. And I loved being there, loved that I was viewing the film for the first time exactly the way I should be viewing it. Subject matter, text, context, all in sync, everything perfect. But if I'd been trying to be bohemian, instead of being conscious of having earlier kissed my wife's cheek and tousled my kid's hair, closed the door of my colonial house in my Ashley Grove subdivision, walked to my Toyota Camry, sitting in my Chesterfield County driveway, rolled through suburban streets until I got into the city, parked and walked into the club, knowing full well that I was floating into a bohemian space and bathing myself with a bohemian experience, but that I wasn't getting wet. I didn't know if I'd have enjoyed it as much. I was not bohemian. If I'd contorted myself to be bohemian, I would have had to monitor my guise, and it absolutely would have been a guise. Instead, I just tried to be as unself-conscious as possible, although I couldn't help wondering if my dreadlocks mediated my suburbanity and this momentary, one-time-only punk experience. Was I a poser? I didn't feel like one. I didn't think I looked like one. I know I wasn't acting like one. And yet, as I stood there, screened on every side, my hair, my body, my being, in constant, surrounded by, immersed in punk, while being myself, decidedly not punk, I did wonder at last how a novelist or a cultural critic or an anthropologist would describe me. It's a section of the book where I'm trying to figure out how this hairstyle that's so unlike the hairstyle that I'd worn my entire life was representing me in ways that I kind of wanted it to, but I was fundamentally uncomfortable with the way it actually was.
So both of you obviously must have origin stories about when you chose to do what you've chosen to do with your hair. Mm-hmm. What was yours, Natalie?
Wow. Well, my story was, it's part practical and part rebel. I started locking when I was in grad school, in film school at Howard University. And that was, well, being at a HBCU, otherwise known as a historically black college or university, and having come from Northwestern University undergrad and pretty much being in predominantly white spaces all of my elementary, middle, and high school life, Howard was like a game changer because I had never been around that many black people in my life. And I was just in awe of the variety, you know, just the textures, the shapes, the colors. It was just amazing to me. And I did experience an awakening politically and certainly in terms of identity. And so at some point after having cut my hair off and then letting it grow out and feeling like it was too much to deal with and combing perm through it for years, and then it started breaking off. I was like, okay, I gotta do something. But I really wanted to lock my hair in some ways to challenge myself because I had definitely grown up thinking that, you know, permed and laid to the side was the best way to roll as a black woman. And, you know, it was a really eye-opening experience because I just pretty much felt invisible for the first year. Actually, the first 5 to 6 months because I just had little buds on my head and I'd never worn my hair like that before. And it felt uncomfortable. It felt, I definitely felt ugly, I have to say. I felt ugly. I felt like I had done something to myself. And certainly, you know, they grew out. But I really appreciate that part of the experience. Like, you know, once you lock, even if you cut them off and then you do it again, you never go through the same experience again because you've already gone through that, like that, you know, you've been a virgin locking and then you know, the hymen is gone. So every time after that, you know, it's not the same. So it really, that first time locking my hair was really interesting to me because I got to see, you know, I really had to check out how I was looking at myself. But I also realized that, you know, I was tripping. You know, most people really did not care what my hair looked like. And there were still dudes that were cute that that I thought were cute, that were attracted to me. They're, you know, my parents still talk to me. So, you know, a lot of the baggage that I brought to locking my hair, you know, I contended with it, and I found that, you know, it just kind of fell away. So it was a very, it was a fraught, but very enriching experience.
Well, if Natalie felt invisible, I felt hyper-visible. I felt like the entire world was looking at me, that everybody had me in their crosshairs and was deciding that my hair looked insane and that I needed to be committed or whatever. But the fact of the matter was that it was as Natalie suggested, a very valuable experience. Mm-hmm. I was keeping a journal at the time. I was pouring into the journal all the things that I was thinking about and all of the identity issues that were attendant to the ways that me altering my hair, and not altering really anything else about me except my hair, until I began to wrestle with my clothes as well, which is another part of the process. But it was and remains fascinating to me the way that this dead protein that grows out of our heads and what we choose to do with it says so much about us and says so much about us to the world, both about us to ourselves as well as the sort of way that we project. In terms of my origin story, I went way back to the late 1970s in terms of the seed that was planted that finally flowered in 1998. And I went back and forth, and I thought about doing it, and then I didn't do it, and I wanted to do it, and then it wasn't the right time. And finally, I just sort of decided at 39, it was time.
What was the reaction of your family?
My wife was with it. She liked the idea.
Well, what about the kids?
My kids struggled a little bit. My daughter was 7. My son was 3. Obviously, they'd never seen anybody. They'd never seen me with my hair that way. They had a sort of fixed sense of what I was supposed to look like. And so they grappled with it and wrestled with it. But after a while, they were into it as well. My son is 20 and has locks. And my daughter's hair is about this long and in an afro, and my wife's is as well. So we come from a kind of family culture where this isn't terribly surprising, but might have been surprising at that time.
Natalie, you used language a second ago about thinking about your physical beauty in the context of your dreads and your locks. And I've heard you say this many times, even in talking about Bartman, Beyonce, and me, your own perceived struggles with American beauty standards, mm-hmm. right? And so on the one hand, we can think about Bert narrating his story of his hair coming out story. And of course, then there's a larger history of black male criminality around hair and locking, et cetera. You tap into something else. Talk a little bit about, you know, trying to work through American beauty standards as it relates to black women and how hair plays such a significant part and how black women see themselves and think they are seen in the world.
Yeah, wow. You know, I guess I have to go back to, you know, the sort of seminal moment in my life when, you know, Bert just talked about a seed that was planted, I guess, in the 70s.
Yeah, late 70s.
And similarly, a different seed was planted for me when I was just becoming a teenager. And you know, my dad is not on social media or anything, so don't say nothing to him because he really wasn't trying to do anything.
Keep him out of this.
You know, he was trying to be a good dad, but and he was a good dad. But my dad said to me when I was 13, I used to love to take pictures of models out of Elle and 17 magazine. So I'm dating myself a little bit. And I would put them on my wall, and you know, to decorate my wall. And I usually put up pictures of women that I thought were beautiful, or I thought, you know, they were wearing something that I thought was fly or whatever, and I wanted to try and approximate that the next day at school. But my dad and my mom were divorced, and so he was not living with me, and he happened to come visit one Tuesday, I think it was, and looked on my wall and, you know, looked at me and was like, "You don't look like them. You're never going to look like them. You're attractive, but you're not pretty." Wow. And I know now, in retrospect, what he was trying to do, because, you know, I'm an adult and I've had a lot of time to think about this, a lot of time on the couch to talk about it. But I, you know, I think he was really trying to, he was trying to be proactive or preventative in allowing some sort of pride or vanity to develop in me. And it was part religious, part, "I'm your dad and I know you are becoming a teenager and you're about to bud in ways that I can't really handle and I'm not in the house, so let me let you know right now that, you know, this is what's going on and I don't even want you to go there." And so in his attempt to try to get me to go the opposite way of, you know, vanity and pride, what he ended up doing unwittingly was creating this obsession in me about, okay, gosh, I'm not pretty. Wow, so, you know, what do I do? How do I, guys don't think I'm attractive? Let me figure this out. Let me, you know, I was attracted to guys that, oh my gosh, I had like no business, you know, being involved with, but it was out of a attempt to affirm myself in ways that my dad had really kind of taken away from me. And so when you hear me talk about just my, I guess, physicality, I'll say, in any way, that's really where it starts. And so I have always had that in my head. And so cutting my hair off, you know, and taking away all the fluff and you know, just the bouncy hair, that was, you know, it was like a mistake. It was something that, especially at that time, I did not feel like people felt, you know, I was not affirmed in that decision, I'll put it that way. And so it was a very sort of isolating and uncomfortable place to be in. And my dad didn't affirm me. My mom, actually, when I cut my hair off, she wouldn't even look at me. She just couldn't even, she just talked down to the floor, and I'm here, and she just could not get it together to address me because she was like, oh my gosh, her hair is gone.
And you had good hair.
And I had good hair. Yeah.
Can we put quotations around that word good?
Right. Yeah. But I mean, good when it was permed. Right. But you know, the whole reason why it got permed in the first place was because it was it wasn't good, quote unquote. So, yeah, that's, you know, that is really the origin of any conversation that I have about beauty. And any attempts for me to like try and reconcile beauty for myself, and certainly what I'm trying to do through Bartman, Beyonce, and me, it stems from that 13-year-old conversation I had with my dad.
So Bert, you were one of these fancy-free California Negroes. as you describe it.
At like 19, your favorite film was Harold and Maude.
Yes.
Wow.
Yes.
Right.
This is true.
So, right.
I will come to that.
And what
wow.
You would
have been listening to on your Walkman is not necessarily
what, you know.
Oingo Boingo, you know, Devo. Yeah.
Right.
So I was that guy.
Location is important in that way, right?
Yeah.
So you're thinking about your hair going back to the 1970s, right? You talk about the
Jamaican girlfriend.
Yeah.
Who's like, don't do it, right? Because, you know, very early
in this, you're thinking about it.
But, you know, you choose to do this not in California. You're
not in New York. You're not in Atlanta.
Not in Louisiana.
You choose to do it in Worcester, Massachusetts.
Right. Wow.
Talk about that, right? Because and this is you. You know, I would have met you the spring of '99, so you would have just gotten the Holy Cross and just started.
Yeah.
So you're already negotiating the whole Boston thing, right? And choose the lock at the same time.
Yeah. I don't know how much the sort of relentless, persistent whiteness of Worcester and Boston and the whole New England area had to do with it. I know it had something to do with it. I'm just not sure how much. But for sure, that was a factor. And I was a professor who had been on campus for 3 years or so. I felt like I was established. And it had floated into my head, excuse me, to have dreadlocks periodically from the 70s, again in the 80s, in the early 90s when I was in graduate school. And this time when it floated into my head, it stuck, you know? And I've had it suggested to me after the book was published, and more than one interviewer has said, midlife crisis, right? Mm-hmm. You know, and I'm telling you, if indeed it was a midlife crisis, because I was 39 years old when I decided to lock my hair, I'll cop to it, but I would also have to say there was nothing conscious about the idea that it was a midlife crisis. You know what I'm saying? And I don't think it was. It was more of a, I'm grown, I can do what I want, I don't have to answer to anybody, I've always wanted to do this, it occurs to me that I should do this, and now I'm gonna do it. That was a lot closer to the kind of thought process that was going on in my head at the time. I didn't know that it would be as topsy-turvy the kind of identity ride as it turned out to be. I should have known, but I found out.
Right, because y'all know who the famous Negro is that comes out of Holy Cross, right?
God.
He's a Supreme Court justice.
They're both proud / ashamed. It's like, we got a Supreme Court justice, a sitting Supreme Court justice. Unfortunately, it's Clarence Thomas. You know, it's a sort of good news, bad news joke that they have there, but yes.
So, like, you can imagine, like, there's, like, pictures of him all over campus, and then Bert rolls in with his lock.
Yes. Wow. That was a sort of fascinating dichotomy, if you will.
How did it change, and this is for both of you, your interactions with students in the classroom? Like, I've heard young black women graduate students who were locked when they're reading their course evaluations. Perceptions of who they are and what they do, drug addictions and everything else. Is that University of Texas?
Wow.
It makes sense because it's the University of Texas,
right?
Just simply because of the hair that they had or chose to wear. I mean, how have students, interacted with you when you walk into the classroom and they see a professor, right? And that's as
apropos to your campus, because, you know, how many Negroes are walking around with dreads?
More now, but not a lot. Right? Yeah, absolutely.
Everybody's pressing late.
Yeah. And weaved.
Well, one of the fascinating things about not just writing the book, but the reaction to the book, is I thought that my experience was a gendered experience. I knew that it was. I knew the fact that I was male and that I was a man of a certain age would have made a difference. I didn't realize how much of a difference that turned out to be. One of the ways is the fact that I've had it suggested to me that one of the things that's missing in the book is that I don't talk about the fact that people are constantly asking me to touch my hair or just sort of violating my boundaries and touching my hair. The reason I didn't talk about it is it never happens. It never happens.
Oh yeah, nobody's touching a black man.
I'm 40, you know, right now. I'm in my mid-50s, right? And I'm a man. And as a result, people don't, I simply don't have the problem that I've come to understand is way more of a problem than I even thought it was. And I knew that it was a problem. So the reality is that it's a gendered experience. Mm-hmm. That if I'm growing my dreadlocks as a man, as opposed to wearing dreadlocks as a woman, the reaction in terms of students and others is different than it would be. Even though the locks are the same, yeah. the body underneath matters.
Yeah.
All I get is pub and he's the coolest guy ever, you know? I get no pushback, how could he do that, no inappropriateness, none. Mm-hmm. I never have from the beginning of 1999.
Well, I'm glad you made the point that it is gendered, because absolutely all the time I have people, want random folks wanting to touch my hair. At the grocery store, on campus sometimes. Interestingly enough, none of my students,
who on campus wants to touch your hair?
I think it's been my white colleagues that have wanted to touch it. But none of my students that I can think of have ever wanted to touch my hair. But I teach at a small black university in downtown Raleigh.
Where Angela Davis's father went.
Yes, that is one good claim to fame. Yes, yes, that did happen. And so, it's interesting. I don't think that my students really have much to say about my hair. And maybe that's because the campus is small. You know, there's a opportunity for faculty to really get to know the students in a way that you don't on a larger campus. And so there's a familiarity that I think, I've never had a student have anything to say in course evaluations or otherwise about my hair. I've had administration have, thoughts about who I am or who I think I am because of my hair. But the students are really the best part of, what I do.
Interesting. Talk about Natalie, and then we'll shift to Bert. The choice to tell your narrative in the long form of a film, and why at this particular moment?
I think it was...
And talk a little bit about the title also, okay. Bartman, Beyonce, and Me.
Yeah, because it was going to be just Beyonce at one point. I think that there are a lot of things kind of came together at the same time. I was maybe 3 or 4 years ago really beginning to try to unpack and understand a lot of what I shared with you about, what my dad said to me when I was a 13-year-old and how that has impacted my life. And as I looked at that and turned all of that over, what I realized was that it was not only something that made me insecure about how I look, but that insecurity then also impacted choices that I made and decisions that I made. And so I realized it was bigger than just, am I cute? Do you think I'm cute? It's about not thinking enough about myself, not believing in my value or worth enough to make choices that are separate from, oh, he thinks I'm beautiful. He thinks I'm attractive. Oh, well, maybe that's who I'm supposed to marry. Maybe that's what I'm supposed to do. I'm serious. And I have, in talking to other black women, who I think are just incredibly beautiful, I keep hearing the same thing over and over again, that it has this the beauty ideal that we nurture in this country, at least, is such that, there's not that much room for black women. And So when we find someone, and if we have not been affirmed in our beauty, regardless of what we look like, if we have been told as a young person, you know, why can't you look like your cousin? You know, your hair is just so nappy, you're too dark, or whatever the comments have been. You know, when that happens, it becomes internalized in such a way that we absolutely make decisions that can be long-lasting about our lives that, you know, just have a really, can have a serious impact, a detrimental impact. And so as I began to understand that, I felt like, okay, you know, I don't want my daughter, who is 10, to go through that. I don't want the young women that I teach on the campus that I teach at to go through that. If there's something that I can do in imparting what I've learned from the experience that I've gone through, which has been very painful, actually, then I want to do that. And so I started having these thoughts and kind of reckoning with all of this around the time that Beyoncé released her Beyoncé album. And that was the first Beyoncé album that I bought and actually listened to from beginning to end and looked at all the videos. And I was at a point, I think, of self-awareness and self-reflection enough that I was able to be really honest with myself and realize, you know what, I'm not feeling Beyoncé. You know why? Because she's beautiful. And I don't look like her. And I began to think about when she and Destiny's Child came out and how I felt. Like I actually tracked how all, like her appearance in the culture made me feel. And I had to address it because I was like, you know what? Again, it's bigger than are we cute? It's about the ways that beauty or our perceptions of it and our perceptions of the lack thereof then distance us from each other as Black women, as women of color. And, you know, and that was not cool. There's just, you know, enough with the jealousy and competition. And I think that it all, I won't say all, but I think a good percentage of that sort of rivalry that seems to naturally exist between Black women, Black girls, you know, the cat fights that break out in high schools and folks slashing each other and, you know, just all the violence that we do to each other comes from this insecurity that we have. And so I want to address that too. And Beyoncé seemed to be a really good and appropriate vehicle for talking about what I was realizing about beauty and about myself. Bartman, which is Sarah Bartman, also known as the Hottentot Venus, came into play because I read an amazing book by the scholar Janelle Hobson called Venus in the Dark. And what she said about Sarah Bartman, and I'm not gonna go with, I'm Google her if you don't know who Sarah Bartman is, but Janelle basically says that Sarah Bartman's specter still hovers in the culture, that she is sort of the prototype for the ways in which Black women are looked at today. And I could totally see that. Beyoncé fits into it. I think all of us, you know, to some degree or another, fit into that in terms of how our culture looks at Black women, looks at us in terms of our sexuality, in terms of our beauty, and, you know, looks at us as the exoticized other. So I felt like, you know, Sarah Bartman is really important, and it has to, the story has to begin there, and then me is me, personally, but also I stand in the gap for all the women of color, all the Black women in particular, and girls that I hope will be transformed by the film when it's done.
Bert, I know you do a lot of work around Black satire.
Yes.
And there's a way in which Twisted reads as satire. Mm-hmm. So I know you enjoy just telling the stories because some of the stories are funny. But why'd you decide to document it the way you did at this particular point?
Well, I've always been fascinated by hair as a cultural text that can be read, and that is the most interesting thing about it for me, is that we see somebody with a head of hair and we think we know them. You know, we think we know who that is. We look at them and we say, yeah, I think I understand that person on some level. We don't think that we really know them, but
we think we have something about them. You listen to Neo Soul.
Right. And you burn incense.
Exactly. That's exactly right. And so, and that's fraudulent on some level. Yeah. We don't know who someone is. I have a friend who I still have in Worcester. Her name is Gloria. And she has worn her hair almost every different way that you can imagine it. And if you saw her when her hair was straightened, you would presume things about her that are absolutely not true. You know, we think we know, but we don't know. And so that it becomes this repository for all sorts of cultural attitudes and political attitudes and presumptions and expectations. And what I wanted to do was try and personify that in a way that would allow it to have both the reflection inside of what I was thinking, as well as monitoring and reacting to the way that the culture responded to me as I moved through grocery stores and bank teller lines and movie lines and what have you. And it turned out to be a really interesting experience. And quite frankly, 15 years later, people are random strangers will just sort of walk up to me, mostly white people, but not only white people, and feel as if it's important to them that I know how much they like my hair. You know? And it's a sort of beacon for reactions in ways that I find.
I like your hair, Black Lives Matter.
Well, they haven't gone that far. But I have had people, you know, I'm walking out of a restaurant and a woman of just a couple of months ago sort of hailed me, and I turned and she took my hand. Just want you to know how much. What is happening in her head that makes that interaction so important to her that she makes sure that a complete and total stranger knows how she feels? You know what I mean? That's the complexity of black hair for me that makes it something that is a virtually inexhaustible cultural text that is the gift that keeps on giving.
So I'm going to go into the more contentious and difficult arena around thinking about hair and black beauty. So the homie Yaba Blay is sitting up there against the wall. Yaba, who will be joining us here in the area, joining the faculty at North Carolina Central in January, published an incredible book about a year ago called One Drop, The Shifting Lens on Race. And it's about all these folks who cover a large range, a spectrum of color, who identify as black. If we see light-skinned, green-eyed dude with dreads, the culture reacts very differently to that figure as opposed to it being a dark-skinned person,
right?
True. And even in the context of dark-skinned male reads very differently than dark-skinned female. How do we unpack the color politics that's also embedded in our conversations about hair, right? No, and don't worry, we're gonna host Yaba here sometime soon in the spring.
Wow.
It's complicated.
Yes.
You know, there's the exotic other, and then there's the threat. And I wonder if a kind of spectrum of skin color, and if in fact you're on the lighter skinned, green-eyed version of it, you're more likely to be read as exotic and attractive in ways that if you're on the darker skinned and male side, more of being read as a kind of threat, a kind of danger to the culture in certain ways. And those things manifest themselves in a variety of ways. And you know, let's face it, the last couple of years, have really brought the question of black criminality and black male criminality in specific to the fore. And your chances of landing in the crosshairs of a police officer who's scanning the culture for threatening behavior is more likely, it seems to me, if you're wearing a hairstyle that's non-traditional and your skin is darker, than if you're even a guy who happens to be lighter skinned and wearing the same length dreadlocks with the same thickness, it seems to me. I can't, you know, that's a supposition more than anything else, but it sort of makes sense to me based on the experiences that I've had.
I'm really struggling to, I don't even know how to begin to address that, because for women, I mean, there's the colorism that which I think is a little more intense among women than it is with men, and then, you know, so we're judged based on our skin color, but then also on our body size and shape, and then certainly hair gets thrown into that.
I mean, you watch Being Mary Jane
every week. I mean, think about how folks react on social media to the chocolate boy wonder that she's with.
The football player?
You can't even imagine a narrative in which a male, black male character who was attracted to a dark-skinned black woman would elicit that amount of affirmation.
Yeah.
You know, in terms of how audiences are reading that narrative.
Yeah. I you know, it's interesting. To me, I think now, especially with social media, Instagram and Facebook in particular, because those are so visual, it feels like we're, at least among black people, at a moment where I think we're doing, well, I don't know if I can say that, but I think that there are more black women who are affirming themselves and each other on social media in ways that I find interesting. And I think it's across, to a certain extent, it's across skin color, but I feel like there are more dark-skinned women, brown and dark and darker-skinned women who are affirming each other, who are loving each other as we are, and who are you know, really kind of making proclamations about how beautiful black skin is. And so I guess I'm saying that because I'm hopeful that that means something, you know, in the long term, that perhaps there is, at least within our communities, a embracing of the spectrum that we've not always experienced. I hope so, because the color and hair politics, like all of that is just so, it's so wearying. It's just heavy, you know? And it's, I guess, you know, that's a part of why I want to do Bartman, Beyonce, and Me, because I just want us to see ourselves, forget what other people think. You know, I want us to get free around how we look and do something different with all of the assumptions and politics that we have bought into around our hair and our skin color.
So let me ask you this before we open it up to the audience. Rachel, our girl from this summer.
Yeah, I was thinking about her.
And you know, part of the reason why she could authenticate herself for a while is because her hair game was kind of tight.
That's right.
I mean, we're just being honest,
that's right?
She
was paid.
Yeah. I mean, she, yeah.
Yeah.
So obviously hair is not enough to get you in the community, necessarily.
Right.
But is there a way in which, you know, folks can pretend authenticity, whatever, however you want to define authenticity, you know, based on having a really tight hair game.
Tight hair game. That is so funny. I mean, I think that, you know, I think a part of the reason why, at least I won't speak for any other black woman, but the reason why I was irritated with Rachel and still am is because I don't think her hair game is tight. That's number one. And number two, I think we all like know this. We've had these conversations on Facebook and elsewhere, but she can put that on and it's cool for however long it's cool, and then she can take it off. And I don't, I think it gets so complicated because I know white people like our friend EP who identify, you know, if you ask them who do you most identify with, white or black, they would say black.
And
if you didn't know that they were not black, you'd think they were black because of the way that they carry themselves and the way that they walk through the world. I'm not gonna talk about Rachel. I think that, you know, there are, one of the things that I really appreciate about Yaba's book is that there are people in the book that, you know, we would probably look at and say, he's not black, but if you saw them walking on the street, but they, that's how they identify. And so one of the things that, you know, I guess Rachel in a way, what's the word? I guess confirmed or reaffirmed for me the need to let go of some of the, you know, these hard strictures that we place around identity as far as black people are concerned. Like, I think she's putting on. That's why she irritates me. I have a problem with her blackness.
You don't think it's sincere?
I don't think it's sincere.
To use John Jackson's language.
No, yeah, I don't. But there are people like EP and other people who don't look black that, you know, would probably go to bat for me and you, you know, in ways that other people that look black would not. So what does that mean? Like, what are we really saying at the end of the day? I have locks and I'm a certain color, and so that means I'm down, and you have locks or don't, you're really fair skinned, green eyes, and you're not down, even though, you know, and maybe you are black, maybe you are mixed race, maybe you do have black blood in you. But I think that we, you know, that's a part of the problem, is that we walk around making these assumptions about who people are based on very superficial, you know, aspects and characteristics that really, at the end of the day, do not matter and don't really have anything to do with who we are.
And yet, we have to walk through the world, and we have to wear clothes, and we have to style our hair, and how we're seen shouldn't be the sum total of who we are, but is a factor in some way. Because if I'm moving through the world and people are looking at me, they know, or they should know, that I've chosen these pants and I've chosen these shoes and I've decided to wear this shirt and I've decided to wear my hair. And how that looks, in a sort of semiotic sort of way, represents an aspect of who I am, even though it can't possibly represent the totality of who I am.
We'll take a couple of questions from the audience.
That one flew into the air.
What's up, Camille?
Hey, so I had locks for like 20 years and cut them off when I turned 40. And when I cut them off, it felt like I was kind of almost like cutting off a limb. Mm. And I want you to talk about, there were some moments where I would whip them up into a bun and like cover them. And then there were some moments when I'm around my people where I want them out. And I wonder if you could talk about just like spiritual consciousness of that, and how locks kind of absorb energy, and if that's something you've experienced, and then also the difference between cultivated and uncultivated. Do you have a touch on that?
By cultivated, you mean twisted?
Ah. It would be called uncultivated.
I see. Okay. You want to go with the whole spiritual? I got to be honest with you. I completely and totally respect the aspect of spirituality that dreadlocks possess for very many people. My theory is that the sort of uncertainty that you were talking about kind of mirrors the sort of uncertainty and the sort of inability to explain certain aspects that spirituality usually rushes in to try and help us deal with what we can't fully understand or control. But for me, dreadlocks are not a spiritual experience. And it's not wholly stylistic either. It's more about identity and it's more about a kind of internal projection. But it's I simply didn't grow them to have a spiritual experience, and that hasn't really been part of my journey.
I mean, I'd have to agree with Bert. Like, I was not thinking about the spiritual aspect when I started my dreads. It was really a political, I'll say immature political assertion, because I just didn't have enough information at the time that I started my locks to, you know, really fully embody all that cutting off my perm and, you know, and beginning locks meant. But I know what you're talking about at the same time when you say that, you know, they can absorb energy. And I think that's why I've cut them. This is my third set. And I have cut them. I probably won't cut this set off again, because and maybe it's because I feel like I'm in a, you know, I'm in a place where, okay, I'm good. But like, I cut them off when I got married and started them again, because I felt like I was going on a new journey. And then I cut them off while I was married, I think a little bit after I had my first child, and was trying to do some other things with my hair that really didn't work, because I was trying to look like Halle Berry, and I don't look like Halle Berry. And I don't have Halle Berry's hair. So I went back to them, and you know, it's true that I think hair can pull in energies that are not, that are not healthy. And so as a result, you know, actually I need to think about that, because it may be time to cut them and start them again. Seriously. Yeah, maybe I'll do that. Detox them or something. But I hear where you're coming from. I definitely think that there's something to it. But honestly, you know, I was not thinking about a spiritual journey when I began them.
I haven't had the opportunity to
meet
before, but...
What's up, Carter?
Hey, Carter.
But could you say something about the diaspora African to the continental African perspective of dreadlocks? And I say that because having been in lived in black expat communities in certain countries, that the perspective and the outlook and the viewpoint of Africans relative to diaspora Africans relative to dreadlocks are completely different. Hmm. I noticed that either drug user, homeless, bum, and whereas from the continental, the diaspora African perspective, you know, somebody mentioned spiritual perspective, power, beauty. And did you, in your book, did you deal with that, or have you had that experience in terms of dealing with people of color from other parts of the world relative to dreadlocks?
Only in the most brief, interactive sort of way. Everywhere that I've gone in the last, 5 to 10 years, somebody's had some sort of reaction, whether it's Berlin, whether it's London, whether it's
Paris.
Jamaica.
Paris.
Paris, right, exactly. there's always been some kind of public reaction, and often related to Rastafari. You know, I'm walking on a street in Panama, and some dude's coming this way, and I hear Rastafari, you know. I'm not a Rasta, and I don't pretend to be, but as I say, the hair talks, and if somebody sees the hair and their frequency is attuned to Rastafari in a way that dreadlocks signify Rastafarianism for them, if they want to chat, I'll chat with them. But if it's just a comment, I'm still moving this way and he's moving that way. That has happened a lot over the course of where I've been. Most of the things that I talk about in the book of a sort of transnational sort of way have to do with how, if you're walking around the United States, at least this has been my experience, people will assume that you're Jamaican until you open your mouth and it's revealed otherwise, you know? And it's really interesting to sort of think you're walking around as a regular old Los Angeles-born African-American guy and have people respond to you in ways that make it clear that they think you're a Jamaican guy. Yeah. That's the main way that I've had to do with a kind of diasporan view of dreadlocks as representing something other than some of the sorts of aspects that you talked about. And that, you know, I keep thinking, since dreadlocks really, as far as my book is concerned, I signal the golden age from the late 1970s, even though it was around before then, to the early 1990s as dreadlocks golden age. Here we are in 2015. I keep expecting it to fade, and it still hasn't. It's like it's woven into the sort of DNA of the style.
But think about that subset of Americans for which, when they think about dreadlocks, they immediately see Mumia or images of folks from MOVE in Philadelphia, right? Because that was the only real person outside of Bob Marley and Rastafarians, right? That was the only Eddie Grant. Right, that was the only kind of public presence
for the Jamaican drug posse. Right. that had its moment in terms of, you know, what that must mean that this person has this.
Bad boy, what you gonna do?
There you go. Yeah. That's it exactly, you know. Yes.
Sort of personal contentions about adopting the word dreadlock, or if you feel one of the other three words is more comfortable for you?
I have a chapter late in the book titled Against Dreadlock, Dreadlock, and I put it in quotation marks, and then I spend what is turning out to be not even enough time talking about why it is that I use the word dreadlocks, and why it's sort of punning, multi-vocal nature is appealing to me personally, as well as the Rastafarians coined the term, and there's an assumption out there, an apocryphal assumption, that somehow it came from, you know, slave owners waiting for Africans to come off the boat, seeing their hair and saying, "Oh, it looks dreadful." And then somehow that word sort of found its way to the 20th century and the 21st century, and that it's somehow negative to use the word dreadlocks instead of, you know, just respecting what it is that the Rastafarians used as the term. And I can't play. I call it out in the book, and as far as I'm concerned, the term is dreadlocks. I like the term dreadlocks. I like the term dread, and it appeals to me. And I'm well aware that there's a sort of wince factor that's always in play whenever I use it. And I'm perfectly willing to explain why it is that I use the term. But I do use it consciously and comfortably.
Me too.
So I believe the bookstore has a few copies on hand of Bert's book if you want to buy a copy. You can, of course, get it online, Amazon, any other choices. You can hear Bert tomorrow as part of the 8th African American Literature / Studies Symposium at North Carolina Central. His panel, I believe, is at 9:30 tomorrow morning. You can hear Natalie and I
every month on WUNC.
The next date is December the 2nd, talking about whatever we feel like talking about on our show, Culture 360. Thanks again to the folks here at Letters Bookshop, and thank you all for coming out.
Thank you. Enjoy it.
That was fun.
All black everything, all black, you know, all black in the name of all my black heroes, all black everything, all black polos, all black medallions, yeah, all black, you know, say, all black everything, all black, you know, all black in the name of all my black heroes, all black everything, all black polos, all black.